Welcome everybody. I'm Yannis Hamilakis. I'm professor of archaeology here at the Zhukovsky and professor of modern Greek studies in the classics department. And today I'm very glad and very pleased to be able to welcome here at the Zhukovsky and Brown a friend and colleague, Nikolas Papadimitriou. Nikolas is currently at the Center for Hellenic Studies at Washington, D.C. It's part of Harvard University. But his base is Athens, and more specifically the Psychiatric Museum in Athens, one of the main archaeological museums and the most innovative ones in Athens. Many of you know the institution. Now, Nikolas has a wide variety of interests, research, curatorial and other. He has done his BA at the University of Athens, and his MA and PhD at the University of Birmingham in England. His PhD was on Mycenaean burial customs, and his PhD became a monograph. Many of you may want to consult a very important one on Mycenaean cultures in Greece. But since 2003, you work at the Psychiatric Museum, he's developed another major area of research to do with, the curatorial dimension, to deal with the presentation of archaeology to various publics, but also to do with the various ways of communicating with broader audiences beyond our peers, beyond archaeology. In addition to his expertise in curatorial matters and his museum experience, he has also developed a number of initiatives, including a number of important seminars. I was able to participate in one of those seminars in Athens last year. And a number of other initiatives that involve a more direct and a more embodied relationship between the public and the archaeological process and the archaeological finds. I guess that broader experience relates to his topic for today. So today he's going to talk to us about heritage, the sector of heritage and the idea of heritage, but also the museum as an institution and heritage museums as opposed to other museums, and how they relate to classical antiquity, how they relate to the presentation of the classical past in the 21st century. So without further ado, I would like you to join me in welcoming Nikolas here.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a very great pleasure to be here, and I want to thank very much Yannis Hamilakis and the Zhukovsky Institute of Archaeology and the Program for the Modern Greek Studies for the invitation. Today's talk will be indeed about the meaning of the use of the classical past in museums today at the second decade of the 21st century. I will try to summarize some recent developments in museum theory and practice, explore new ways of engaging with the past, and identify the possible place of the classical in this complex now and in the future. I will speak about different types of museums, although my talk will also draw extensively on my own experience from the from Greece and from the Cycladic Museum. I have held this picture, which was chosen by Yannis for this lecture, exactly because it's not what you would call classical. It's Cycladic stuff. Some people would place it within the classical tradition today. And it's interesting because also it shows this fluidity of the term classical. And this is important for me because working in a museum, unlike the Cycladic, the Museum of Cycladic Art, I became very early aware of this not very clear-cut distinctions between what we mean with ancient, what we mean with modern. And actually, I was quite attracted by this thing, the modernity of the ancient objects like the Cycladic figurines. But as you all know, this simplicity, this modernity was not always appreciated. In the 19th century, archaeologists used to describe such objects as barbaric, rude, or even bestial. And it was only after the modernist movement in art that scholars and artists started appreciating them and even described them as poems in marble. So this sudden and rapid passage from obscurity to stardom always attracted my interest. Now to our subject. I suppose that the question, what is the meaning of the classical past in the 21st century, may sound strange to those of you who have not lived in the 20th century. But it may sound familiar to those who have experienced the end of the second millennium and felt that life was accelerating, technological changes were becoming difficult to follow, and we had all the feeling that the 21st century may be something quite different. One can indeed list here of significant changes that took place at the transition to the new millennium. An acceleration of the process of globalization with all its good and bad consequences, large-scale environmental degradation, mass movements of people, often in the form of forced migration, increasing cultural intolerance and the rise of fundamentalisms, and also the appearance of new digital technologies which are transforming the character and the content of our communication. Now, how Muses respond to these challenges is an interesting topic, but the question, what is the meaning of classical today, is an old one. It comes regularly under the surface of Western academic discourse in times of change. Perhaps the earliest known case of such a debate is the late 17th, early 19th quarrels between the ancients and the moderns. This intellectual battle between those who believed in the paradigmatic use of antiquity and those who praised science and progress as the values of modernity. But the question emerged again and again since then. In 1921, the famous historian Arnold Toynbee tried to explain the penchant of scholars for studying the classical past. To do so, he offered a biological metaphor which seems quite entertaining today, was then meant to exemplify the derivation of Western thought from ancient Greek philosophy. In this metaphor, Greece was described as the womb of Western cognizance, Rome as the period of pregnancy, the so-called Dark Ages as the moment of birth, the Middle Ages as the childhood, the 14th and 15th centuries the puberty, and the time since then as the prime, thus creating the necessary links. Of course, this may sound funny today, but we need to understand Toynbee, of course, was somebody who could take distance from what he was studying. But the important thing is that he was writing in a time of radical change, just after the First World War, we're talking about 1920s, okay, beginning of 1920s, and a little before the rise of the fascist party in Italy and the Nazis in Germany, both of whom made extensive use of the classical past in their propaganda, often with the assistance and guidance of leading academic authorities, as explained in this excellent account of the German case just published in English. Almost 70 years later, an impressive array of classical scholars and philosophers, from Nicole Leroux and Marcel Detienne to Cornelius Castoriadis, convened at Le Mans, France, to discuss the importance of the Greeks and the Romans for European modernity. Incidentally, this meeting took place at the aftermath of the fall of the Berlin Wall, which was a great marker of change in 1989, and the practical end of the Cold War. And the discussion focused extensively on such issues as the forms of democracy, the notion of modernity, and the perception of the other. In 2006, another great authority, the director of the Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa, Salvatore Settis, wrote a very interesting book about the future of the classical in a globalized world, where he stressed that every era has invented a different idea of the classical to create its own identity. As the classical does not concern only the past, it is also concerned with the present and the vision of the future. Setti suggested that the notion of the classical appears in rhythmical circles in Western discourse and proposed that the classic can become again important if it abandons the static jargon of the elites and be used as a key for accessing
the multiplicity of cultures in the modern world and the way in which these cultures are penetrating each other. It is interesting that all those who wrote about the meaning of the classical past from the 17th century onwards, they had two things in mind. One was the change, the notion of the change. All of them were aware of the changes brought about by the events in their time and looked back into the pool of the classical tradition for some kind of reference and perhaps ideological guidance. And second, the notion of relevance. All of them were concerned how relevant the classical tradition may be to what was happening by that time. It was, in a way, as trying to readjust a well-established system of values into a new capsule of historical conditions, or to use a more modern metaphor, as trying to transfer an old but functional software into new hardware. I do not want to imply here that the classical tradition is an outdated subject, but rather that for many people it is an important tool, a kind of software, in order to understand their world, what we call the hardware here. So much more than a clearly defined period or era of study or area of study, the classical is a system of thought, a worldview that defines what we call Western cognizance in many ways, and therefore it is related with issues of identity and ideology. Now, the way museums have historically dealt with the classical past has been the subject of extensive criticism in the framework of postmodernity and postmodern theories. The large encyclopedic museums of the 18th and the 19th century, the first museums, have been heavily blamed for promoting colonial worldviews. It has been suggested that their methods of collection were the result of imperialist practices and that their content and structure promoted Eurocentric systems of thought and values which marginalized other forms of cultural expression. One may have serious objections to the details of this thesis, yet it is true that future historians will be surprised to find out that museums in Australia or in America held collections of Greek and Roman vases from the very beginning of their history, but it was not until an advanced stage of the 20th century that indigenous cultural objects gained the right to be exhibited as part of local or national heritage. The classical past has been also blamed for being linked with nationalism, especially in countries like Italy or Greece. It is true that the statements of leading revolutionaries of the 19th century, like the Greek Yannis Makrigiannis, who is quoted to have said it was for these marbles that we fought, and the Italian Massimo D'Azeglio, who famously said, "We have made Italy, now we have to make Italians," do suggest that the integration of the classical into national narratives was a conscious project, the project of creating, forging national identities in countries which consisted then by culturally and linguistically diverse populations. This, of course, was part of a wider phenomenon in the 19th century, when newborn states tried to justify their historical right to own the areas, the lands they occupied, and at this historical interface, two important things happened. First of all, the past, which until then was a neutral temporal notion, became territorialized, broken into national histories, and conceived as property, cultural property for that sake, or more kindly expressed later as cultural heritage. The second is that classical antiquity, although claimed by Greeks, Italians and other countries as national heritage, remained as a kind of supranational point of reference, at least for European intellectual elites. But with the widening of public education from the later 19th century onwards, it gradually penetrated broader sectors of Western societies, obtaining the form of a cultural phenomenon, meant to express a shared heritage and common aesthetic or political values, which theoretically at least had to do with progress, reason, modernity, and democracy. And for that reason, they were often juxtaposed with the values of cultural others, like the Ottoman Empire in the 19th century, or in the 20th, various totalitarian regimes. This idealized perception, of course, was soon to collapse. the unashamed and very effective use of the classical by the most totalitarian regimes of the 20th century, fascist Italy and the Nazi Germany, so that the classical does not have an inherent benevolent or progressive quality. How it will be used is a matter of political decisions in the present, and this changes also a bit our topic, which is not only how relevant is classical antiquity today, but also how it can be used in a progressive way. Now, in order to locate this question in the landscape of today's museums, we need first to discuss two major developments in museological and archaeological theory and practice. First, we need to consider that after the emergence of museum studies as a separate field, sometime in the 70s, 80s, theoretical debates about museums have shifted from the methods of representation to questions of public participation and social inclusion. Museums of the 20th century have been seen as authoritarian institutions that imposed grand, unifying narratives over large populations, thus excluding from representation a wide number of social and political minorities as well as indigenous cultures. Therefore, great emphasis is placed today in the relation with local communities, the promotion of local histories and indigenous archaeologies, and the incorporation of diverse modes of perceiving the past in museum practice. This may sound fascinating, but it has also a lot of problematic aspects. For while such views are meant to democratize museums, they also intensify the territorialized perception of the past, if only on a local scale. They suggest that people should speak about their own past, not the one which is imposed by museums and other institutions. But in doing so, they raise again questions of ownership of the past and thus create paradoxical situations. For example, if indigenous populations, say in Australia, have the right to own their past, and this right is recognized legally in Australia, how can one say to the Italians, the Greeks, or the Egyptians that they cannot claim the classical heritage as theirs and ask for the restitution of all stolen treasures? And if all antiquities are to return to their place of origin, how can we speak of a common heritage or understand cultural diversity in the past or in the present? There are no easy answers to these questions, but I would like to mention that this kind of ethno-regionalism is felt even within a single country, like Italy or Greece, where we have the phenomenon of local museum claiming objects found in their region, their locale, from national museums. Now, the second development we need to consider concerns the changes in international legislation concerning the acquisition of antiquities. Trying to fight illicit digging and trafficking of ancient cultural objects, UNESCO has produced a number of conventions since 1970 which prohibit museums from acquiring unprovenanced or looted objects, and most of them have been ratified by most countries. Archaeologists have been very active in this field because illicit digging destroys what they today at least understand as the primary source of archaeological knowledge, the excavation context. Therefore, they have been critical of those museums whose collections had been built through acquisitions from private collectors or early explorations of the 19th, let's say, century that paid little attention to the recording of context. Museums are also blamed for adopting exclusively art historical approaches. And sometimes such reactions take very polemical form. In a recent publication, Colin Renfrew chose to disregard, from his analysis of early Cycladic sculpture, all marble figurines which have no known provenance, which, however, amount to almost 40% of the total. This was a kind of a casus belli for a museum, I have to say. Other eminent academics have reacted to such purist views, such, for example, John Boardman and Robin Osborne, have argued that the excavation context is only one among the meaningful contexts of an archaeological find. It can provide information about the conditions of deposition and perhaps its use, but it can say little about its place in the history of art, the development of a particular technique, or even its social symbolism. They have also stressed that some of the most significant advances in our understanding of classical art have resulted from museum-based stylistic studies, and also by the kind of scientific and laboratory analysis that can be conducted only within the controlled environment of museums. This is a complex issue, for looting is supported by a vast network of very powerful private collectors who are willing to pay exuberant amounts for fresh antiquities. Therefore, refusing to include in archaeological studies museum objects without specific provenance does not really solve the problem. It only condemns museums to continue doing what Renfrew blames them for, treating archaeological finds as art objects. As Osborne explains, the real question here is not how to punish museums for their past practices, but how to integrate them with scientific research, and this can be achieved only through closer collaboration between museums and universities. The above changes have affected variously different types of museums with classical collections, and with this I refer mainly to four kinds of institutions which differ in size, resources, mission and practices. Among them, the first and the most famous are the metropolitan museums, like the Met, the Louvre, the British, Berlin and Vatican museums, the Hermitage and others, which have had a major impact on our interpretation of the classical past and were pioneers in research over the past decades. But the success of such museums and their survival depended heavily on the continuous acquisition of new and even and ever more impressive artifacts. Given the restrictions imposed by international legislation now, it is highly improbable that these will continue in future. For that reason, such museums have either shifted their attention to other types of collections or redirected their resources towards the organization of large-scale loaning exhibitions, as for example, the program of the Metropolitan Museum in New York from 2003 onwards, with brilliant exhibitions for the third, second and first millennia in the Mediterranean and the Near East, and recently for the Hellenistic period. Such exhibitions require extensive research, high-level curatorship and daunting logistics, as they involve loans from dozens of institutions around the globe and the spending of considerable funds for shipping, insurance, designing and constructions. Yet once such mechanisms are set up, it is quite easy to establish the connections with other museums and to attract sponsors, and the outcome is always profitable. Now, the second type is the university museums, like the Penn, Princeton, Yale, Harvard in the US, the Smithsonian, the Fitzwilliam museums in the in England, and other museums in Germany, France and other countries. Such museums have a great advantage today, as they're actively involved in primary research, both through ongoing excavations and through the study of all finds. University museums can combine the study of well-recorded archaeological contexts with art historical perspectives and socio-political approaches, which allow for the placing of finds into wider interpretative frameworks. For that reason, they are the most likely beneficiaries of the changes that are taking place today. Being in direct contact with academic research, they can function as intermediaries between newly generated knowledge and the public. Most university museums are still reluctant to organize such ambitious exhibitions, which require extensive loans, logistics and exhaustive curatorships, and prefer more standard exploratory shows. But they have great potentials and can become big players in the museum scene if they decide to be more innovative in their approaches and take some reasonable organizational risks. Then there are the public archaeologists in countries like Italy and public archaeological museums, sorry, in countries like Italy and Greece. And these are museums that have also profited by the recent changes, as well by European Union funding, which has allowed for some impressive renovations and the exhibition of many new objects, which until recently were in storerooms. But there is still a significant gap between the national museums, which have their own curatorial staff educators an independent budget, and local or regional museums, which, although receiving the bulk of new finds from archaeological excavations, have no dedicated staff. The archaeologists working there have also to do rescue excavations and bureaucratic work. It is then left to larger museums to dictate the policy towards the past. Of course, very often, such museums fell victim to the traditionalism of the archaeological services and their own dependence on centralized ministries of culture, which are more interested in loaning objects for blockbuster semi-touristic shows abroad than for original research exhibitions, which in itself is a bit funny given the huge reactions caused in Greece 40 years earlier, where the first law for cultural loans was voted, and here is a poster that had been published then. When left in peace, however, such museums can do great work. The National Museum in Athens has since 2000 launched a number of large-scale exhibitions, some of which were dedicated to specific periods or assemblages, as for example the Antikythera Rec, by far the best museological presentation in Greece so far, while others are more self-reflective, as a recent exhibition on early travellers in Greece and their impact on our perception of the ancient past. Such exhibitions exploit the advantage of the National Museum to pull continuously new objects from its storerooms and have been achieved through extensive research and curatorship and at least 2 years of research and preparation needs. Now, the tendency towards self-reflection, that's another image of this exhibition, is also seen in a number of recent publications and presentations where the history of the museums themselves is shown, discussed, and evaluated. And here are some pictures of the history of the National Museum. Here, image from the Second World War, the hiding of the antiquities. Now, finally, some public museums have been also particularly active in organizing special tours and educational programs for people with various types of disabilities or for unprivileged social groups. Not all museums are like that, however. The New Acropolis Museum, however famous it is, not only dedicates itself to the Greek national cause of showing to the world what is missing, but also ascribes to the old view that the past stops where antiquity ends. 15 centuries of use of the Parthenon as a Christian church, Ottoman mosque, fort, and even the planned palace of the Bavarian king Otto are summarized in a 5-minute video, which quite few people see. The past of the Acropolis is only classical, full stop. Now, the other categories of museum is the smaller museums, which exist in Europe or Americas, with small collection of classical art, usually of unprovenanced nature, as they have been created through donations by private collectors. Such museums often lack specialized staff and use their collections mainly for educational purposes. But precisely because they are not bound by the restrictions of excavated assemblages, they can introduce new insights into our understanding of the past. This is what we have been trying to do in the Museum of Cycladic Art, which is one of these very small museums, private museums, through exhibitions, educational programs, and several other activities. Trying, for example, to introduce the idea of multiple viewings of the classical past, we decided to organize two distinct exhibitions which focus on ancient images. In one, we treat these images as reliable illustrations of ancient daily life. In the other, we explore the symbolic and social meaning of these images. So visitors can see both of them and decide what is their preferred view. Most known, however, are our thematic exhibitions, which focus either on cultural interaction in antiquity or on major concepts of human life, such as love, death, and health, examined diachronically. A great success suggests the relevance of such subjects to people and societies today. This turn towards major themes of human experience and cognition also seen in other exhibitions, as for example, a very successful exhibition defining beauty at the British Museum, which examined changing perceptions of the beauty in antiquity, have been described by some as a psychoanalytic turn in archaeology. And incidentally, this year, we have launched a new seminar from like the ones that Yannis was describing, which has exactly this subject, archaeology and psychoanalysis, where representatives of the two fields discuss over a number of topics, and the seminars are available online for those understanding modern Greek. We have been also highly interested in modern perceptions of antiquity and how the past interacts with the present, a topic we have tried to explore again through seminars and other activities, but also through exhibitions. Now, this relation between the past and the present seems to be a special interest lately. A recent exhibition at Brussels featured Greek antiquities exhibited among modern works of art. And we know that the Festival Documenta 14, which takes place this year in Athens and Kassel, and this title, Learning from Athens, will lay also emphasis on such interaction too. Now, the relation between ancient material objects and current forms of perception, or new media, is actually very little explored, but seems to have great educational potentials. And I will learn here from our educational experience, the experience of our educational department. Some of you may be familiar with the animated movies produced by media specialists through the opening of the Acropolis Museum in 2009, or for other projects. But last year we tried to use the same technique without the help of any specialists, and try to work with some school people, some teachers, and try to see what they could reproduce. So, if I manage to show you a very short video, which is something that kindergarten instructors created in 4 hours after a seminar we made, using replicas of figurines that we had offered them, and the techniques that were learned by some specialist instructors of the University of the Aegean. After the seminar, they introduced these techniques in their classrooms with a key, and the kids responded enthusiastically, and the results are available in our website. Also, our educators have decided to play with well-known ancient forms. One of the most interesting things they do is that they launched an open competition in which they provided the outline of a Cycladic head and asked kids to draw whatever they liked in it. The outline of the Cycladic, the response of the kids was huge, more than 6,000 participants. And the results were so refreshing that eventually we decided to present them in an exhibition. The competition was actually an exercise on the art of illusion, as defined by Eric Gombrich and described very well in this image. The kids learn how to see differently and how to free themselves of the limitations posed by existing concepts and categorizations. Finally, we have tried to respond to another recent trend often described as the demystification of antiquity. As you probably know, a lot of people complain because museums do not open their storerooms to reveal the hidden treasures. Of course, there are no hidden treasures. The only treasure that hides in museum storerooms is the experience gained from work and research. So several museums have launched programs of open conservation for the public, which are very well attended here at the Acropolis Museum. In our case, we decided to do something quite different. We decided to revive ancient crafting techniques, making an unusual installation which combined ancient objects and live workshops, where modern artisans presented how artifacts were manufactured in antiquity using traditional tools and techniques. The response by the public, both adults and kids, was enthusiastic, and some videos have been also uploaded in our channel on YouTube for those interested. Now, these are some examples of the things that even small museums can do and describe, I believe, the diversity of current museums' efforts to develop new kinds of relations with the material past. Before moving on to some conclusions, I would like to refer to another two topics which I believe are very important for museums. The first is a subject to which Yannis Chamilakis has contributed significantly, and this is the question how we sense the past. Several studies have shown that sensorial perception does not relate only to biology and physiology, and how we see, hear, or feel is also subject to social and cultural norms and traditions. It has been also demonstrated that each sense has a different functional mode. We perceive differently things through sight, touch, or hearing. This suggests that a sensorial museum experience should move beyond standard practices of providing three-dimensional tactile works for people with visual impairity, a practice which simply translates for blind people what visitors with full vision can see. And there are several research programs currently or completed which are trying to find out how to develop a multisensorial approach. A similar project is running also in our museum for kids. Although still at an experimental level, this kind of research will bring about fundamental changes in the way we perceive museums and exhibitions, and will also affect our approaches of ancient Greek culture, whose understanding has been based heavily so far on visual modes of perception. A small example of the kind of changes that may occur in future is provided by the Kelvin Group Art Gallery in Glasgow, where curators decided to ignore completely traditional categories and classification schemes and exhibit together seemingly disparate things such as aircrafts, birds and mammals in a gallery that is not concerned anymore with species but with the very idea of motion and space. How important such a perception is or can be for the classical past may be revealed by the forthcoming exhibition Emotions of the Onassis Cultural Foundation in New York, opening in a few days. The second topic is related with digital technologies. Such technologies have affected museums in various ways. Each museum has now what we call a digital self that works independently of the physical space of the museum, and multimedia enhance the experience of the visitors and allow for the personalization of museum visits. Games provide also new and open-ended forms of interaction with the past. In this game, the players assume the role of a leading personality of Athenian society, and their goal is to do whatever they can to avoid the outbreak of the Peloponnesian War. Here, the designers are not interested in what really happened, but in what could have happened. In other words, in the historical possibilities rather than the finished facts. I find this an extremely interesting and instructive exercise. But the most long-lasting impact of digital technologies is that they go against standard linear narratives, which are the standard way of presenting things in museums and in history in general. As long stressed by media experts, digital technology is based on hyperlinking and the free movement between one context and another, what we actually experience when we are navigating in the internet. In that sense, it fiercely negates linearity and promotes a networked structure of thinking which is both multidirectional and open-ended. Media theorists and philosophers have discussed extensively these issues and suggested that digital technology actually challenges the very notion of historicity as developed in the post-Renaissance world. According to them, the digital revolution is probably the most important change in communication after the after printing, or perhaps even after the invention of writing. Now, I will not judge these opinions, but I will say that to capture the potentials and dangers of such a transformation, classical antiquity provides a wealth of parallels. Scholars like Eric Havelock, Jack Goody and Eric Gombrich have demonstrated the impact of the change from orality to literacy, from aniconic art to iconography, and from direct to symbolic communication in ancient Greece. Exploring these aspects further may make the ancient past seem again very modern and very relevant to people and societies. Now, what I have presented so far is a rich but rather unorganized assortment of the many different ways in which museums, in which the past, the classical including, is treated in various types of museums today. The summary that I would like to do includes the following. Changing conditions in archaeological research and the regulations concerning the acquisition of antiquities have reconfigured the museum landscape, offering opportunities to different institutions, especially university-affiliated museums, to assume a more active role as intermediaries between primary research and the public. Many examples around the world suggest that the public is highly interested in the past as an object of study and investigation, rather than as an idealized symbol that has to be continuously praised, as is too often the case with classical antiquity in museums. For the classical to survive in this test, we have to abandon exclamatory approaches and exemplary references and examine it as a proper historical period with its positive and negative aspects. Exploring the negative points of Athenian democracy, for example, may be much more creative and politically progressive than continuously praising its positive aspects and justifying its failures and the numerous exclusions against women, foreigners, and so on, saying that we cannot project current notions of equality to the past. Understanding historical conditions is one thing, and another is to ignore social discrimination altogether. It is also clear that people, especially younger ones, are interested in wider, comparative and open-ended approaches that bring in dialogue different historical entities and cultural concepts, even if seemingly very remote to each other. This suggests that we may have to take the classical past out of the almost sanitized conditions in which it is studied today, bring it in closer contact with other forms of cultural expression or perception, either ancient or modern, and eventually challenge its very conceptual borders and its porosity. We may be used in having classical collections and departments of classics, but it may be time to reflect on our practices and examine them critically, for when the past is studied for long in isolation and with extremely high degree of specialization, it may become introvert and self-referential. The museums offer good environments in which interaction among different forms of cultural expression and perception, including the classical, can take place. The changes brought about by novel modes of communication, like digital technologies, will introduce new ways of thought that will certainly challenge the system of thinking represented by the classical. The software we were talking about at the beginning will probably need updating. But in what direction is hard to predict. The classical tradition itself was born out of such a communication change in antiquity, and studying the structural similarities of the changes then and now may be both instructive and progressive. Finally, as to the ideological and political role of the classical, its historical and ethical weight guarantees that it will continue to be employed in identity games. One of the most ideologically charged projects in Europe today is the establishment of the so-called House of European History in Brussels, which combined with multi-million European Union funding directed towards the reinterpretation of European history, represents what Sharon MacDonald has described as a top-down effort to integrate the many histories and archaeologies of European countries into a single master narrative meant to promote a sense of European citizenship. This novel invented tradition has already made extensive use of classical antiquity, which no doubt will become a cornerstone of collective identification. But no matter whether one agrees or disagrees with the idea of European citizenship, what we have seen is that such top-down projects can use beautiful ideas like the ones expressed in Greco-Roman philosophy for many mean purposes. One of the things that museum theory has targeted towards lately is to reveal the dangers of such top-down projects. The current multiplicity of approaches to the past in museum environments may seem chaotic, unorganized, but it is the result of an effort to desacralize the past, the classical including, and make it more user-friendly, while at the same time maintaining a distance that is critical in order to build a balanced relation with the past. New methods of dissemination and outreach help to make historical knowledge widely available to people in an attractive but reliable form as a public and distributed resource. This distribution of resources is the best response to top-down projects and the basic requirement of the democratization of knowledge. Museums love the classical past because it is full of representations that are so attractive to people, images, myths, poems, and all kinds of narrations that can be easily visualized. For that reason, this relation is improbable to break soon. But the described changes, the desire of museums to be more socially inclusive, and the need felt by all those working in the area of the classical tradition for politically progressive approaches necessitate a reshaping of this relation. This reshaping has started and may take some time until it produces perceptible results. But it is a process that will most probably affect both museums and our perceptions of the classical. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Nico. I think you gave us a very rich and very wide-ranging kind of apparatus of ideas, images, thoughts to reflect on. All these things resonate with many of our courses here and teaching as well as research. So I'm sure there is plenty, or should be plenty of questions and comments and thoughts or even disagreement with something you said. Who wants to start? Okay.
I'll try to put this together in a coherent way, but one of the things that's sort of interesting about going to museums such as the Acropolis Museum in Athens is that museums show their singular objects, right? I mean, you show the good stuff, and it's unique. And yet, one way to sort of try to approach the understanding or the interaction that you're talking about is to show the boring stuff, but to somehow make it interesting. And so thinking about that and putting it together with the digital that probably already exists in the back, which is the metadata, the catalog information, the sort of the way of dealing with lots of stuff together, is something that we never see. And I just wonder whether trying to surface some of that more abstracted classificatory information in some way might, and therefore the sort of the masses of sort of like or boring or very slightly differing materials might be something really interesting to try to get at.
I'm not sure that this will happen on real space, but it's already happening on digital space. So not necessarily with the Acropolis Museum, but with many other examples where people have today direct access to inventories, okay, and they can use them however they like. So now the fact that every museum site has the My Museum section, so if you go there, everybody has his own or her own museum, means a different, yeah, I don't like it either, but that's the reality. I suppose they're not, but it's a possibility, and if there is a possibility, I mean, I have never used it myself, but if there is a possibility, if it is there, it means that one way or another, at some point, people will exploit this personalized thing. I find the personalization of cultural experience as another kind of problem, but let's not discuss about this. I agree that museums will never lose this thing because people go there to see the original. And this is psychon.
Have a more direct connection with tactile and the physical as opposed to the digital.
But I think that the change that will happen will affect our perception. The change that the digital will bring will affect so much our perception of space that the exhibitions will be different. Not because they will use digital, but because, in one hand, we'll have different perception of space, and the, as I said, the other interesting development is all the sensorial thing. That's a major concern in the museums, how you experience this. And if you go in the Acropolis Museum now, there's no any other classification. The only idea of the director is to feel like you would feel if you were in, that's why you have this forest of statues.
I was wondering, so with the exercise that you did with the children with the Cycladic figurines, the point of that was to kind of encourage the children to think of these as also modern things that they could project their own ideas. I was wondering if you could just talk sort of, what do you feel like the kids get out of that?
First of all, the realization that seeing is something that you learn, and you the game with the duck or the rabbit is something that's interesting if you know from the very very beginning. So this is what they first learn. You mean how what they acquire. The second thing that museums generally are trying to do now, in Greece at least, where the antiquity was something which was almost sacred, is to let the kids feel free, you know, to be a bit creative with such kind of things. I mean, just forms, do whatever you like with them. Okay, it's not, even if it is an object. I mean, the funny thing we have with this thing is we have replicas of figurines. Yeah, okay. And at some point, you know, people are afraid with replicas. I said, it doesn't matter. If you want to do something, break it. I said, no, I cannot break it. I mean, that's interesting for Yannis that he studies such kind of things. People cannot break the replica. So it's interesting for the kids to detach from this, first of all, to detach from this ideology of the ancient thing. And also, for me, it's interesting to have all this distance from the idea of the perception. To believe that your perception is the only possible perception. To believe that what you see is. If you understand what I mean.
Yeah, I just mean, I guess I'm wondering, so I remember very vividly the exhibition that you had probably about 10 years ago with Picasso, right? Yeah. There was a sort of, the Picasso, you know, among the figurines. I almost felt like or upon reflection, I'm wondering if this idea of looking at taking Socratic figurines in particular and sort of suggesting, I think back to that really famous passage of Plutarch's Life of Pericles that is often used when in discussions of the classical, where it said that the Periclean buildings on the Acropolis, you know, they're imposing and rich and, you know, already old at that time, but they always seem new. And that there in that passage, it seems like that's part of their mystique. And I feel almost like this kind of, like the, you know, putting the Matisse or the Picasso next to the Cycladic figurines, for me, it like deepens the mystique of those figurines, like they contain some sort of eternal truth or humanity or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
To them.
Okay, just to answer for this, that was an exhibition that was not an art exhibition, actually. It was mostly an archaeological exhibition. So the whole idea was to understand how our own perception of the ancient objects has been affected by the artistic movements of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. Not only, you know, how much the artists have been influenced and to build this kind of relation. Although I don't see why this is something we should you know, dislike. If artists want to be in dialogue with it, well, let them be. I don't see why this is something bad. Why archaeological museums should be historical museums? But they say that this exhibition, actually the most interesting thing is how the representations that these artists made. The thing that I liked mostly is that by putting everything in paper as forms, a kouros, a cycladic figurine, and something, how they changed our perception about this and decontextualized them. And we started seeing them really as forms, as outlines, rather than as real objects. So this is interesting also for our own work and for the people who see them, I think.
I think we have a question
to
yes.
Well, I'm just thinking that you're butting up against the fundamental supposition of the art museum that the object is sufficient unto itself. And that's a pretty hard pattern to break, but in doing so, you're able and to offer not only context for the objects, but context for the viewer, so that the self-awareness is what your goal is, really. Having taught some students starting a course with what's the most interesting museum experience you've ever had, invariably they talk about science museums, not about art museums, because of the explanatory content and the immersive experience.
Yeah. I think, first of all, this is a matter of age. When they become 45, the best experience will be the art museums. I mean, that's our problem, how to invite young people in museums. And how to make things immersive has to do very much with our own perception of archaeological objects as sacred, really. So, as I say to young kids, usually I say that, you know, sometimes you... Today you can take a piece of stone from a place, from a beach, and go somewhere. If this is called cultural heritage, you will probably go to jail. And this is what happens with antiquities today. So, no, I don't say that we have to stop all this legislation, but we need some kind of balance on all these kind of things. And this is one of the problems that Yanis has described, that tactility has been impossible because we have not to touch. We have only really to praise this kind of antiquity. So this is a problem, but we have to live with that. Okay. And one of the things that I find very annoying, being also an archaeologist and a museum person, is all this conflict between archaeologists and museums. And okay, the antiquities trade is something that will be resolved by the police, not the academia. So it's time to stop with these things and find how, you know, we can bring more context than that. But again, I say that the only context is not the original ancient context. The context that people give today to things is also an interesting context, or the context that artists gave on the 20th century or the 19th century. And that's why I believe also that museums should reflect on themselves, how they... the most interesting thing for me, at least in museums now, is to see how they exhibited the same things 30 years earlier. So that's an interesting
thing. This is a good moment for me to actually ask my question in relation to the history of your museum, Cycladic Museums. You invited us to reflect on the history of Cycladic figurines as a collection, and the whole debate about context, the collector, the role of the collector, and of course your museum was created because of Tony Goulamris's collection, and because of the distraction that collection caused to the archaeological context of Cycladic culture in Greece. So, if museums are about addressing the difficult moments as well, and the difficult unfinished histories, to what extent you can do that in your own museum? Do you have the freedom to confront that history directly and show the consequences, and also the political role of the museum today and days?
There is a... I think that I mean, now I have to speak a bit about. No, I speak about to explain this. I have to speak about a bit administrative things, because such museums, I mean, private museums in Greece are not like in the States, so they are all subject to the Ministry of Culture. So, according to the Greek legislation, the objects themselves belong always to the state. Okay, even if they you have them as a museum, they always belong to the state. So. One of the problems with this kind of discussion is that if you open, we would like to open it, that I think that it would be a very interesting exhibition, interesting discussion, because it will go beyond the dichotomy, you know, of looters and excavators and things like that. But one of the problems that you have there is that, you know, there is a ministry that has all this tendency to feel, the Ministry of Culture and Greece feel that, you know, they have a mission to protect, they feel like missionaries. They feel more like missionaries than scientists, let's say. So that was the main problem. It has happened now, because we have a cycladic exhibition now, and there was a requirement by the Central Archaeological Council that such a section will exist. So there is a section on that thing. But I do think that would be a very interesting discussion in all museums. And it has been interesting in cases of, you know, museums like the Metropolitan or the Getty, when they put the objects, contested objects, into analysis, because these objects become also stars, and people go to see the fake object that looks like an original.
Yeah, it's a difficult discussion that many big museums actually do not want to open, like the British Museum, for example. That's another story. Any more? Yes, Peter.
What struck me in your presentation as you went along, that what I personally sort of realized I was missing from is one of the kind of museums or type that has been striking for me in Europe as being transforming is this small focused museums. You touched on it a little bit, but they are all so rural. It struck me that most of the museums that you were speaking about are urban based, and even if they're sort of focused on specific, you know, like the university museums you signaled out, but I'm thinking more even. You know, museums that are associated with specific sites where you visit
site
the
museums,
and those sort of things. But not just site museums, as many, it's to do with European funding, and also, you know, every sort of village has been wanting to open its own museum, and even although the majority sort of close sometimes already a day before they're opened. It's still that, I think, that has, if you look at just numbers, that has contributed quantitatively to an enormous quantity of stuff that's out there exhibited, and a lot of people can potentially sort of access.
In such small
regions. And how does that sort of fit? Do you see that as sort of, because it's also, it's sort of, I've always found it sort of in between the sort of top, it's not really a top-down narrative, but it's local authorities that are involved. And it sort of corresponds, matches European guidelines, and so how does that sit in your discussion?
I say that in countries like, as you know very well, like countries like Greece and Italy, anything that has to do with antiquities is centralized. It cannot be more centralized than that, actually. Okay. So even if you know, a small museum that wants to do something with the past, and with objects, though, however, and they have to go through these kind of, you know, very strict. And usually, you have power exercising by the ministry in such places. So it will take some years until you can do something there. And also because these kind of museums, they do not have at least the public museums, the small museums, they don't have staff. So if you have a museum, you need staff. You cannot. It's either or. Either is a storeroom or is a museum. If you want to have it as a museum, you need staff. You need at least one curator, somebody who primary job will be curator, and at least one educator. If you don't have them, and it's not a matter of the crisis problem, it's how the whole system is organized. Now, what will change this is the new initiatives of the EU that are trying to combine landscape, tourism, and culture, which, you know, they ask to have all these integrated, holistic, let's say, approaches, that an experience will not be only I go to see a museum, but I go to the museum, I see the landscape, I see all this kind of thing. These may change a bit the things. But unless we, you know, start to adopt a different think against the antiquities, which has started. You know, there are all these programs that people can go in touch, and it's difficult to go a step further. But you're right. And there is another category of museum I didn't mention, and that's the museums in which have a lot of classical objects, let's say, in places where classical archaeology is not probably the top priority, places like Damascus or places like North Africa, but that would take us to different discussions. So.
Yeah. More comments, questions? Just as a comment, I was interested in your discussion about the European heritage and the latest attempt by you to create a material past.
Yeah.
Given all the unsuccessful attempts so far, like the E-Celt exhibition or the Bronze Age, all these things, what do you think is going to happen with this new initiative?
I think because it is so much centralized, it happens today now, a few people, because it is so much centralized and because it comes from the European Council, it will never work because there are so many reactions from all the countries that it will never work. So if it was something, you know, more independent, mm-hmm. for example, you have the Mediterranean Museum, the Musée de la Méditerranée, now in
Marseille,
which is now suddenly you have, you know, in concrete form something which was, you know, a field of discourse. I mean, somebody was speaking about the Mediterranean interaction, mm-hmm. Peter as well. So, but suddenly you have a museum of the Mediterranean is, you know, as if this is, you know, something there. But the European Museum, I don't think it will ever happen. And there are so many also reactions by the countries themselves. You know, that all the funding is not used. Yeah.
That's true. I would think that as well. But at the same time, you know, you could be surprised because if you think of Brussels, precisely what they're doing, it's everybody was saying the same thing when they started the Europalia exhibitions, and these have become, in fact, sort of hugely successful, and people are always looking forward. Which country is doing the next Europalia exhibition? So,
you never know. Yeah, that's true. We may be surprised. Yeah.
Any more comments, questions? In that case, I think we should thank Nikolas again.
Thank you very much.